Turn once again to Exodus chapter 20. After Jesus had healed a woman who had literally been bent over for 18 years because of a demon, the ruler of the synagogue got all indignant because Jesus had healed her on the Sabbath. And he began saying to the crowd, "There are 6 days in which work should be done, so come during them and get healed, but not on the Sabbath." It's in Luke chapter 13. Jesus was constantly in conflict over this issue. What is allowed on the Sabbath? What is required on the Sabbath? What is forbidden on the Sabbath? In John 5, again, Jesus heals the crippled man by the pool of Bethesda. And in verse 10, "So the Jews were saying to the man who was cursed, 'It is the Sabbath, and it is not permissible for you to carry your pallet.'" It's the most ridiculous irony. A man crippled gets healed, and oh, don't walk. And in verse 16, it says, "For this reason, the Jews were persecuting Jesus, because he was doing these things on the Sabbath." Now, what in the world happened to the Jews of the time of Jesus where this was the application of the Sabbath? I mean, think about it. We'll read our text, and then how did they get there? Well, there's a little legalist living in each of our hearts. I mean, I worked for years with a guy who always wanted to add that extra step, that extra area, text of protect. I just think it would be wise. And I kept saying, this is not the way to do things. You can't add your personal predilections to God's law, because it always becomes the law. At the time of Christ, there were 39 major types of labor forbidden on the Sabbath day. The first 11 dealt with bread preparation, sowing your field, plowing your field, reaping, binding sheaves, threshing, winnowing, selecting, grinding, sifting, kneading, and baking. And you thought that the "here's how you do a sourdough starter" is hard. This was one step beyond all that. The next 12 applied to how you're supposed to prepare clothing, which included everything from sheep shearing to the details of how you sew your clothes. And remember, this is all to help people keep the Sabbath. We just want to help you. These man-made additions to the law were to be observed by following 7 steps in preparing a deer carcass to be used for food or leather. Well, it just takes the fun out of hunting, doesn't it? The remaining items dealt with writing and building and starting fires or putting out fires, transportation of goods, carrying from one place to another. They also had other provisions concerning the observance. A Sabbath day journey was about 2/3 or 3/4 of a mile. You know, that's okay, but a mile would be work. It was also counted Sabbath breaking to look at a mirror mounted to a wall. Now that's a little, not quite following the logic there. Or to light a candle, but you could hire a Gentile to light the candle for you. You couldn't carry a handkerchief on the Sabbath unless it was sewn to the sleeve of your garment. Oh, well, good. Is this what the Sabbath was designed for, ordained for? Minuscule little details about how you bake bread or blow your nose? Of course not. No. So what I want to do this morning is look at the reasons for the Sabbath, first of all. And then next week, we want to look at some perspective coming from church history make some more focused applications. So Exodus chapter 20, beginning in verse 8, this is the law, fourth commandment, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male or your female servant or your cattle, or the sojourner who stays with you. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So throughout church history, the question of whether to observe the Sabbath, and if so, how to observe the Sabbath, has been a source of controversy and argument and confusion. It involves many widely related themes. And before you ever get into how to apply, you have to understand where this comes from and why God gave it. So the first thing we usually think about in this kind of a study is whether or not the Sabbath as an Old Testament or Old Covenant ordinance, especially as we find it right here in the fourth commandment, is still obligatory in the context of the church. In other words, is the new covenant assembly still obliged to obey the fourth commandment? Now, I've said for years that I don't believe that any Christian is simply allowed to set aside any of the 10 words merely because of the often misquoted, we're not under law, we're under grace. We've talked about that before many times. So if the 10 commandments are, as I believe them to be, a more detailed and specified, codified version of the original moral law that Adam received in the garden, and he was obligated to keep it, then how can anyone today say that you can violate any of these 10 words while you're justified and under grace? That's the primary argument that you'll hear from many Christians today, especially when it comes to the fourth commandment, remember the Sabbath to keep it holy. Now, here's the logic I believe that I'm drawing from. Since the law is not grace, and then this particular law is not grace, since there were many old covenant stipulations attached to it, therefore, it must not be something to still be observed. That's where they're coming from. Well, here's the problem with that. This same law, that is the law that God gave Adam in the garden, we call it, using systematic language, the confessional language, it was a law of comprehensive obedience. What does it mean to be comprehensive? That means it takes in the whole circle. Comprehensive obedience. That was what Adam was obliged to keep in the garden. It was first written on his heart to be a perfect law of righteousness after the fall, and was delivered by God on Mount Sinai in 10 commandments written on 2 tablets. And I think if it wasn't for this fourth commandment, you would have more Christians saying, yes, we agree, the 10 commandments is for today. I'm going to pull rank. I'm an older guy. I've been around the block a few times. I've been in church many years. My informed opinion is that it's the fourth commandment that people lose their minds over. I think it's the biggest stumbling block when it comes to some people obeying the law of God. In fact, I found a quote by Greg Bonson. I mean, there's a quote by Greg Bonson about everything, but this one's really good. And this more has to do with the overall import of the law, and that's this. The practice of Jesus does not encourage a disregard for the details of God's law, as though New Testament moral duty is bound by a small subsection of the Old Testament law. Jesus was often challenged by the traditionalists. Remember, you got 6 days to heal, come back on one of those days, but not on the Sabbath. The traditionalists, they took their authority from outside the Bible. That's very important. He was often challenged about his activities on the Sabbath. In his defense, he would respond, "Have you not read in the what? Law." Citing the Sabbath activity of the priests. It's especially eating grain. Had the law been outmoded by his coming, of course, such a vindication of behavior would have been baseless. In other words, it wouldn't have mattered to say that. And over again, Jesus could show that the traditionalists, whose boast was in the so-called details, were actually violating and twisting the law. So I quote that just to say that the idea of the law and the fourth commandment now being set aside and abrogated, and usually by some kind of principle of love, it's a great error, and it leads God's people astray. So before anything else, let's consider God's law is a covenant fence to keep you from straying and to keep the pagans from coming into your area. What does it mean to remember the Sabbath? Now, I'm taking a lot of this from Dr. Tom Nettles. It's been a great help to me in this area. So first of all, the Sabbath commandment was given to God's people to provide them a time where you and your fellow image bearers of God could remember and imitate and think about, meditate, remember the rest that God took after all of his work was done. You've heard Vodi Bakum when he says, you know, people ask me, do I believe in God created everything in 7 literal days? And he says, of course not. It only took him 6. He rested on the 7th. Amen. So in light of God's work and then now his redemptive work in Christ, we want to emulate this because of what Scripture teaches, the nature of this one day in 7 rest really is. Remember, when the Israelites received the fourth commandment, they had just been redeemed. That's how we set the whole law up. I am the Lord your God. I brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. Matt made allusions to this with our own sin. Don't go back to that. So the kind of imitation and meditation upon God's rest from his work is not just some arbitrary requirement that God gave the Jews at Mount Sinai. It reflects a baked-in moral principle for all people because of creation itself, especially given the relation of the Creator to creatures like you and I, made in his image. It begins all the way back in the beginning. So Genesis chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. You don't have to turn there. You may if you want. You can keep somebody from looking things up in their Bible. That'd be weird. No. Genesis 2, 1 through 3, thus the heavens and the earth were completed and all their hosts. So God has just created all things from nothing. And by the 7th day, God completed his work, which he had done, and he rested on the 7th day from all his work, which he had done. Okay, so if that's all we had, that's not really a prescription. It's a description of what God did. But the very next verse says, then God blessed the 7th day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all his work which he had created and made. So for Israel, covenant people just redeemed from slavery in Egypt, the seventh day was set aside to be kept holy, to be sanctified for that very recognition, based on God's rest from creation. So God sets the pattern, and his image bearers follow that pattern. While they were wandering in the desert, led by Moses, the central focus of this Sabbath was rest. Rest from their normal labors. Remember when they were told about the manna? Said, on the sixth day, you gather enough for the next day, which was different than all the other days. If you tried to do that and store it, what happened to the manna? It got stinky. You couldn't use it. But on the day before the Sabbath, you could, and it would be preserved. So they weren't to go out and work. So number one, we have this, the principle of rest, cyclical rest. Later on in Jewish history, a major element of obedience to God was in the setting apart and observing the Sabbath. And we saw that from Nehemiah. What was going on in Nehemiah's day when what we read, Greg said, I'm not gonna let you come in here with your donkeys. What was going on? They wanted to continue business as usual all 7 days of the week. These were the exiles that had come back from Babylon. They're trying to rebuild the city, and they're thinking, hey, we've been doing this the whole time. Why not make a little extra cash every day of the week? And he's like, no. All these traders, they're camping outside the gates thinking that you're gonna let them in like you used to. Nuh-uh, not on my watch. He says, then I warned them and I said, why do you spend the night in front of the wall? If you do it again, I'm gonna come and clip your ears. I will use force against you. And he commands the priests to purify themselves and act as gatekeepers. And what does it say? To sanctify the Sabbath day. They were supposed to be considering one day in seven rest a delight, in which they rested from their regular labors and the pursuit of their own profit. Pursuit of the pleasures of their own work. That's Isaiah 58:3 says this, behold, on the day of your fast you find your desire and drive hard all your workers. It's not supposed to be. And then in verse 13 of Isaiah 58, if because of the Sabbath you turn your foot from doing your own pleasure on my holy day and call the Sabbath a delight, the holy day of the Lord, honorable and honor it, desisting from all your own ways. So what's going on in the Old Testament is that instead of the people of God imitating their Creator, resting on the Sabbath, they had just gotten into the habit of business as usual. Now, some of you older folks might remember when resting on the Sabbath was normal. You had to get gas in the car Saturday if you were going to go somewhere Sunday. Does anyone remember? Right. Right. And if you're going to take a long trip, you're going to have to go to a truck stop to get gas. You know, those long, extended things. You couldn't just count on stores being open on Sunday. It was not normal. And again, like I said earlier, I'm old. I remember this stuff. Get your picnic food all ready because there's no Piggly Wiggly. And now it's just Chick-fil-A. People, Christians who want good chicken on Sunday, well, can't get it. Chick-fil-A's closed. Why? Because they're giving their workers a day off. Can you imagine being a Christian business and requiring your workers to work on the Lord's day. See, we think of this as something that's from a bygone strict area. Now we're free. Back in those days, the government would actually shut things down on Sunday. Oh, how horrible and tragic that would be. That's backwards. No, I know people whose job depends on them working on Sunday. Who's being restricted? It's the man who wants to go to church with his family. Oh, can't do that. We're requiring you, mandatory overtime, they'll call it. On the New Testament Lord's Day. And by the way, that's also binding his conscience. He really believes I should be taking my family, but I'll lose my livelihood if I don't work. By the way, 100 years ago, 200 years ago, those men in England who, the early industrial age, you were 7 days a week, 12 hours a day, 16 hours a day in the mine, in the coal mine, in the factories. When they finally got around and said, okay, this is crazy, and they enacted the so-called blue laws, Sunday blue laws, it was a relief. They were overjoyed. Oh, thank God, I have a day that I can enjoy with my family and go worship God. We don't understand. We think... All right, so back to the biblical. We'll talk more about that next week, but I just had to say that because I remember gassing up the car. That's all there is. So after the Jews returned to the land after their exile in Babylon, the Sabbath then at that time became also a time of instruction in the scriptures. So this is what we find Jesus doing, observing the Sabbath in the practice and using that day to give instruction from the Word of God. So he would use it to give instruction about himself, the true importance of the Sabbath, the meaning of the Sabbath. Remember in Luke chapter 4, where he stands up to read and, these things are fulfilled and everyone's like, who do you think you are? He came to Nazareth where he'd been brought up. And as was his custom, he entered the synagogue and stood up to read. Remember, he reads from Isaiah. And then Luke 6:6, another Sabbath, he entered the synagogue and teaching. So this was Jesus' practice. It was also Paul's practice in his early evangelism. If you think about Acts chapter 17, 1 through 4. Now when they had traveled through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica. I know. Where there was a synagogue of the Jews. And according to Paul's custom, he went to them and for three Sabbaths, he reasoned with them. That was paitho, means dialogue, reason. From the scriptures, explaining and giving evidence that the Messiah had to suffer and rise again from the dead. And saying, this Jesus whom I'm proclaiming to you is the Christ. So again, it would have been normal for a rabbi to go into the Sabbath and teach. Well, here's Paul about ready to upset the apple cart. Everywhere he went, he caused riots because of this. And what happened as a result? Well, some were persuaded, and they joined Paul and Silas along with a large number of the God-fearing Greeks, those that had been Gentiles but listening, and a number of the leading women. So churches that were founded under the work of the apostles began meeting together not on the seventh day, but on the first day. Now that is still a point of contention with some. Do you know there are Seventh-day Baptists out there? Yeah, oh yeah. It's not just Ellen G. White and the Seventh-day Adventists. In fact, I've mentioned this group in Syracuse, but they deny the Trinity, so they don't really count. But anyway. But all through the Bible, we don't have a prescriptive text, but we have many descriptive texts. And this was in recognition and completion of the work of redemption of Christ, as confirmed in what cataclysmic, incredible event that changed everything? The resurrection, which is the first day of the week. 1 Corinthians 16:2, on the first day of every week, each of you is to put aside and save so he may prosper and collections be made. This was the first day of the week. Now, we heard from Romans 14. We've gone through that before. And Paul writes to the Romans there. This is where it kind of goes into the Jewish practices of the time. He said it's perfectly fine for believers to put one day ahead of others concerning special observances throughout the year. And you could be a Christian and participate or not participate in that day. It's okay. Without any negative reflection on the gospel itself. And Paul was thinking specifically of those extra special Sabbaths that were part of the Jewish national calendar. Again, it's always designed that God's people would give gratitude to God and remember his blessing, his provision for them. But the problem was that some Jewish Christians were insisting that you have to maintain that same old covenant rhythm, and so do the Gentiles. That's where the issue was. Colossians 2:16 refers to this. Therefore, no one is to act as your judge in regard to food or drink or in respect to a festival or new moon or Sabbath days. So all this means that since the advent of Jesus and the accomplishment of his work, remember Sabbath, God finished his work, now Jesus has finished his work. All those special days that were in the old covenant are no longer relevant to Christians. Have you ever heard of these Christians who will celebrate the Feast of Booths, Pentecost, Passover, and they do so just like the Jews would do. Only they say we should do this because it's God's law and we want to obey God's law. Well, the problem is it doesn't have any relevance to the new covenant or the gospel. In Leviticus 23:24, it says, speak to the sons of Israel, saying, in the seventh month, on the first month, you shall have a rest, Sabbath, a reminder by blowing trumpets, a holy convocation. So for some Jews, this might still be something they want to observe. It recalls special events in the life of their ethnic people. And you wouldn't be denying Christ at the same time. But here's the other part of that. There can be no doubt at all that a Christian could not go back to the sacrificial system without denying Christ's finished work and his priesthood. And therefore, any Sabbath connected with the Day of Atonement is not only abolished, but forbidden. So the upshot is this: special days in themselves that commemorate maybe a historical event, they can be observed without a denial of Christ's rest from his work of atonement. Now, there are Christians, though, that believe that it's a compromise if you celebrate Christmas or Easter or even the 4th of July. Even Thanksgiving shouldn't give that any special significance. Here's the thing. Obviously, you can maintain your spiritual status as a Christian without lighting fireworks on the 4th of July, or conversely, lighting fireworks on the 4th of July. If you have a Christmas tree, you're not violating any of this here. The point is that Paul's not talking about the day of the week for Christian worship as negotiable. It's a very common error. People will look at this passage in Romans 14 and say, well, he must be talking about the Lord's Day worship, right? In fact, what I found really concerning, and I've got this big boat anchor of an ESV study Bible, and it actually represents a lot of evangelical thought. Listen to what it says. The weak thought that some days were more important than others. And given the Jewish background here, the day that is supremely in view is certainly the Sabbath. So think of what they're doing. They're saying the strong think every day is the same, and both views are permissible. Each person must follow his own conscience. And it goes on to say that it classifies the Sabbath command as part of the ceremonial laws, no longer binding on New Covenant believers. Now listen, that's in the well-respected ESV Study Bible. They just said that the one day and seven principle is only part of the old ceremonial law. And I think it's ironic that they would impute someone's commitment to the Lord's Day as being weak in the faith. I mean, it really calls into question some of the most profound and deep thinkers of especially the Reformation. Just for example, the Second London Confession has a chapter of 8 paragraphs that are dedicated to religious worship and the Sabbath. And one of the phrases says that the Sabbath, quote, from the beginning of the world to the resurrection of Christ, that's what we talked about from Genesis chapter 2, from the beginning of the world, from creation itself, and that was the last day of the week, and from the resurrection of Christ was changed into the first day of the week, which is called the Lord's Day and continues to be to the end of the world. That doesn't sound like someone whose faith is weak. That sounds like a sound theology, especially when we see what the early church did. They met on the first day. I think it's just a huge stretch, and it's incorrect to say that this fourth commandment is relegated purely to Jewish ceremonial practices to be dispensed with and basically subjected to relativity. Whatever you think it is, that's fine. That's not what Paul's talking about. See, when we view the Christian Sabbath's vital connection to the worship and honoring of God, it recognizes that God owns the world to begin with. The world was brought into existence by God. And this one day in seven worship that we gather together to do is a perpetual recognition of the character of God, his finished work, and as a manifestation of his glory. Yes, there were particular covenant statuses given to the Sabbath to Israel. And for Old Covenant Israel, the Sabbath was actually protected, like we see Nehemiah doing, with certain civil and ceremonial requirements. And by the way, what was the penalty for breaking the Sabbath in the Old Covenant? Anyone? Slap on the wrist? A fine of 2 drachmas? It was death. Death. This is God's special possession, the people of God. So whatever civil and ceremonial aspects, those extra additional Sabbaths, no longer intrinsic, but what is intrinsic is the moral character of the fourth commandment. And by the way, violation of the Lord's Day is not a capital crime. No one's suggesting that it should be. So what I'm saying is that the purpose of the Sabbath is so that God's people would remember God. Remember the Sabbath so that you remember God. Remember his work. Remember his provision. God provides everyone with light and rain and sun and goodness, but especially you, God's people. He provided Jesus Christ as the only atonement for your sin. See, the identity of the new covenant is no longer ethnic or national. And the fundamentally moral character of this fourth commandment still applies today. There are probably some of you going, so what can I do on the Sabbath? That's next week. I wanted to establish the reasons first. The principal reason is so that you aren't enslaved to a 24/7 job. You rest because God rested. You remember. Every Lord's Day we ask, God, remember us. We're your covenant people. It still stands as a testimony to God's covenant faithfulness and the claim that he has on the affections of all people, especially his own people. So as we enter into worship every Sunday, we are remembering God. We remember the work that was accomplished on the cross by Jesus Christ, his person, perfect in character, his work where he laid his life down and he obeyed the Father in all things so that his new covenant people would look to him in all things and we would repent in haste and that we would be forgiven and that we would be a people who Christ is washing in his word to make spotless, would be eager for good works and all of these things. And God allows us one day in seven to come before him and to not do your normal work and to be with your families and to worship God and give him thanks. Give him thanks. Amen. All right, let's pray. Lord, we are so grateful for the privilege of coming before you and coming into your presence because of Christ. We thank you for this day of rest, a day that we can be reoriented to the things that are true, that one day in seven, where all the rest of the week it seems that the world is desiring to drag us back down and to lie and deceive us, that we could come into your presence, hear your truth, eat your truth and drink your truth, and to be renewed in our spirits by your spirit. So Lord, remind us of who you are. Remind us to be grateful for everything that you've given us, to consider it a blessing to come before you and to honor your Sabbath. We thank you and we give you all the glory this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.